Good evening. Sydney's gangland war has erupted right in the heart of the city with a cold-blooded assassination, igniting new fears of an all-out war.
Tonight we have exclusive pictures of the moments Bilal Hamze was ambushed, gunned down in front of witnesses in a vendetta police fear could soon claim an innocent life.
It was an ambush as targeted as it gets. Public, brutal and so close it was all but impossible to miss. The gunmen are in this black Audi. You can't see the shots, but you can see who they hit. Bilal Hamze, flailing on the ground on the corner of Bridge and Tank Stream in the heart of the city. These are the final moments of his life. As he lays dying, the Audi heads back up Bridge Street for another pass. It does a U-turn, slows, and this time the gun is visible. Multiple shots from someone's right hand, and Hamze stops moving. The next chapter of a crime war written in blood.
I was in bed reading, and all of a sudden I heard several shots go off, three, four, five.
He was screaming on the floor when I come here, there was crowd.
The gunman dumped the Audi 9 kilometres away on Fleming Street, Northwood. There, it was torched.
We heard a bang and then looked out, and then the car burst into flames.
It was seen in the area, and that vehicle will be forensically examined.
7 News was told as far back as February a contract had been taken out on Bilal Hamze. He had been living in hiding in a city apartment not far from here. The rumour mill in the underworld today suggests the price of his life was $750,000.
He's been warned that he's at risk. He's been given advice as to his safety, and that advice was not received in the sense it was given.
It is the world in which the Hamzes live, dragging their families along for the ride. They gathered at the Auburn home of Bilal's mother, Maha, who was shot here multiple times herself in 2013 over her son's debt recovery attempt that soured.
Excuse me, fellas, can we have a word?
For months, the Hamzes have been exchanging threats and gunfire with the Alameddine family based in Maryland. We sought comment today at an Alameddine home shot at in February, days after the Hamzes' home was targeted. Nobody came to the door.
We will be using all our skills and resources to make sure that every criminal in Sydney that has any inkling of this offence, any involvement in their crimes, any involvement in their business, will be suffering the attention from our squads.
And that is exactly what police did today. Raiding the homes of senior figures in both clans, enforcing firearm prevention orders, pouring cold water over reprisals that will follow.
We'll be going across the next few days intensely, and then over the next few weeks as demand and intelligence drives us.
Thursday evening in the city was busy.
We hate to see any innocent person be injured or killed.
The fortunate benefit for police is that they have plenty of witnesses, but what they're yet to discover is how the gunman knew precisely when and where to find one of Sydney's most prominent underworld figures.
And that is good intel, and it's obviously strong evidence as well.
And Robert Avadia joins me live now. Rob, good evening. So the ongoing family feud, it is the most obvious lead for police.
Michael, good evening. Yeah, the most obvious, the blindingly obvious one, in fact, and certainly the highest priority for organised crime detectives going forward. But it has to be said, not the only priority. They have to keep an open mind on this. We saw with Operation Ironside only last week an earthquake in the underworld. Police have been expecting power plays, and this could well be one of them, a third party capitalising on that pre-existing friction between the Hamzes and the Alameddines. Remove a criminal rival, have the two of them blame each other, and the more they fight with each other, the weaker they are, and that third party can gain traction. Always moves on moves in the underworld, Michael.
All right, Robert Avadia, thank you.
You may be asking why this gang war matters to wider Sydney. The answer is collateral damage. Innocent people caught up in the crossfire. At least 3 members of the Hamze family, 2 women and a 13-year-old girl, have already been wounded quite severely. Victims of a war that's raged across Sydney for years, ever since jailed leader Bassam Hamze founded the Brothers for Life gang. Key members have included his cousin Mahmood, killed in 2013. Brother Majid shot dead in 2014, and now another cousin, Bilal. Many BFL associates and their enemies have been murdered, wounded, kneecapped, arrested, jailed or fled overseas. So who are their enemies? Well, some are rivals like Bilal Houcha, now in hiding, and Hamad Assad, shot dead in 2016. Then there's their Alameddine family, Talal, doing at least 13 years jail for supplying the gun in the Curtis Chang police murder. He's in Goulburn Supermax, where he had a savage fistfight in 2018 with Bilal Hamze. Outside, the rivalry, whoever's involved, is deadly. An innocent man was wounded at Hurstville in January this year. And in February, Auburn Hospital was hit by a stray bullet, almost wounding a nurse. Now that Bilal Hamze is dead, the question is, who's next in the line of fire?
Morning, everyone. Detective Superintendent Danny Doherty from Homicide Squad, State Crime Command. Here with Detective Superintendent Rob Critchlow from Criminal Group Squad. About 10:30 p.m. last night, emergency services were called to the intersection of Bridge Street near Pitt Street in the city, right in the middle of the Sydney CBD, following reports of a man being shot. Police were told a number of shots were fired by a person or persons, more than one person anyway, who was passing in a black vehicle that left the area. The injured man was treated at the scene before being taken to St Vincent's Hospital, and that man later died as a result of the injuries sustained during the shooting. Initial identification of the man has been confirmed as 34-year-old Bilal Hamze. A crime scene was established in Bridge Street between Pitt Street and George Street, and it has been forensically examined, and that is still continuing as we speak. That has been done by our forensic specialist police and ballistic police. Detectives are conducting an extensive canvass of the area, and that is involving not only talking to any witnesses or potential witnesses, but also looking for CCTV, anyone with mobile phone footage or dash cam footage. A short time after the shooting incident, police located a burnout vehicle in Fleming Street Northwood, which is in the Lane Cove area, and a second crime scene was established, and inquiries are still continuing to identify whether that vehicle is linked or connected to the shooting. However, initial inquiries indicate it was seen in the area, and that vehicle will be forensically examined. Detectives from the State Crime Command's Homicide Squad have established Strike Force and Glory to investigate the circumstances surrounding this murder. Strike Force detectives from Homicide Squad will be assisted by and supported strongly by the Criminal Group Squad, Raptor, and officers from Central Met Region, as inquiries will continue. This was a brutal execution-style murder and was carried out in a busy street in the middle of Sydney CBD. It was extremely fortunate that members of the public were injured, and as investigations continue, we'll work with specialist police to ensure the safety of the community is our priority. Detectives will now explore a number of inquiries, including the ongoing conflict between rival families and organised crime networks. I'll hand over to Detective Superintendent Rob Critchlow.
Thanks, Mr. Doherty. Our Deputy Commissioner last week forecast that we'd see some increased violence after the resolution of Operation Ironside and the impact that's had on a number of criminal groups in Sydney, and this appears to be a possible result of that. We are still investigating, of course, and working close with our partners. It's vital to remember the harm that these groups are causing to our community. The violence that they prosecute through their business practices makes our Sydney city a less safe place, and we can't stand for that, and we will not stand for that. Whilst the Homicide Squad lead the investigation, as alluded, detectives from Criminal Group Squad will be working side by side with them, along with our colleagues from Sydney City and the Central Metropolitan Region, to make sure all our resources are focused on detecting the offenders from this crime. What will also be happening too is that we will be using all our skills and resources through Criminal Group Squad, assisted by our colleagues in Strike Force Raptor, to make sure that every criminal in Sydney that has any inkling of this offence, any involvement in their crimes, any involvement in their business, will be suffering the attention from our squads. We will be opening doors, we'll be kicking down doors, we'll be tipping people over, we'll be talking to them, we'll be harassing them within the bounds of the law to make sure that they know that we are there. There are going to be several arrests that flow from this. We already have one person in custody this morning, not for this offence, for unrelated offences. But the criminal groups need to know that this behaviour brings a laser focus of the authorities onto them to reduce this crime and this harm to our community, and we will not rest until we resolve as many of these offenders as we can, and we assist the homicide squad to achieve the results that they need to. These strategies will continue. As alluded, Strike Force will be doing overt things. You'll see them out and about. You will see them very clearly leading the charge on behalf of the community. What you will not see is our covert work. We are doing a lot of covert activities with other agencies. We're doing covert activities using our skills and resources. We're talking to people who tell us things to allow us to investigate further. We have used these skills to reduce crime and violence across the last several months. You will not see the outcomes of that apart from peace. We have headed off a lot of violence and will continue to do that. But rest assured that business will not be business as usual for criminal fraternity in Sydney after today.
Danny, why would you want to live this kind of life where you've got a contract on your head and you're looking over your shoulder every minute of every day and exposing your family to harm? Can you get your head around that?
No, and it's again, it's the criminal milieu. It's how do you work out how people think, and it's obviously, and you know, it's a point where it's an age-old question. What drives people to do what they do? Is it greed? Is it notoriety? Is it, you know, the fact that there's obviously easy money in relation to the drug industry and also in the criminal crime and criminal organisations. Any organised crime network requires greed, I think, is one of the main motivational factors.
Was Hamze by himself last night when he was shot?
I'm not going to comment on who he was with. All I can tell you that he was shot on the street. One of the lines of inquiry is who that person was with, who he might have been in contact with, either before or during the actual shooting. That's part of our main line of inquiry.
Had he been at a restaurant beforehand, or was he going home, or what had he been doing?
We believe he left an establishment nearby, and then as he walked onto Bridge Street, he was shot down in a hail of bullets.
That's pretty good intel, not only for where he was, but his movements being outside of that exact place. Whoever he was with at the moment, are they being looked at?
Obviously, people that he'd been in contact with or associated with have been spoke to as we speak. That is good intel. It's obviously strong evidence as well. How the person knows that he was where he was at that time is obviously one of our main lines of inquiry.
Can you expand a little bit further on how Operation Ironside falls into this?
From the homicide squad perspective, we will work with all our other squads, our regions, and we'll also work with our other agencies. And if there is any information or evidence that's captured with any other agency, we'll obviously speak with them and review it.
But does it appear that kind of this is there's someone moving into someone's turf because there's been arrests made elsewhere?
Again, as it's been alluded to before, when once you disrupt organised crime networks, there's always going to be some irritation. And this may have been a result of that. I'm not saying it's the, if it is or not, but obviously you've got to look at those things. There's been a major disruption across the criminal network, across not only Sydney, but across the world. So you know, we have a lot of lines of inquiry out of this shooting this morning. There's been a number of murders of late, which we are either working on or assisting criminal groups with. And you know, that's an obvious line of inquiry. Is this as a result of that, the activities from last week and the disruption and the major resolution of the jobs? It may or may not be, but obviously we'll look at that. And if there's any information or evidence that's out there, that's what we really would like to have. And we'll be in contact with other agencies.
Danny, can you tell us more about the contract that was out on Bilal's head?
I can't tell you anything in relation to that. Again, we also got to remember it's a line of, it's a major line of inquiry. It's a strong line of inquiry that there is a conflict between families and criminal networks. However, we've got to also keep an open mind. There may be some other motives and other people linked to this. So while we look at that and we delve into the history of Mr. Hamze and his associates, we have to keep an open mind.
The recent conflict has kind of been, some of the violence and the murder has been restricted to certain areas. Mm. Does it spilling into the CBD, is that just a major escalation? Like you don't see this in the CBD?
It is a major escalation. You know, as we've seen in the past, we hate to see any innocent person be injured or killed. This could have easily led to that. You know, you're in the CBD in Sydney. We've all been there, into that intersection. We all know at 10:30 on a Thursday night, it's still a pretty busy place. I saw people leaving pubs, restaurants and other places and motels. So it's a, it is an escalation. We're lucky that we haven't got more casualties. We're lucky that there's no one else injured. I suppose on the other side of that, the flip side of that is there may be some people that are actually more who would have witnessed it and seen things. So there's a lot of CCTV, there's a lot of people out and about. So that would be in our favour. But yes, we hate to see it in the middle of the CBD, something like this happen where, you know, a large number of shots continually fired on a city street.
Given those circumstances happening in the middle of the CBD, you know, when he's walked out of a restaurant or bar, wherever he was, does that indicate to you that this was well planned and it might have been in the making for weeks, if not months?
Well, it obviously looks that way, doesn't it? It's a point where that's, we're not saying it is or isn't, but it looks that way. It's someone who knows where he was at that time to be able to be in that same spot and you know, fire a number of shots and kill him. It's a line of inquiry we'll be looking at. And again, this could be, you know, as we said, it's escalated behaviour. It's violent behaviour. As Mr. Critchlow said before, we can't stand for that as a community. No one should be, and we should be and appealing for everyone who can assist us in that, both either openly or in confidence. But again, the line of inquiry is, yes, they knew where he was, and it's one of our strong lines of inquiry, and maybe it may be able to assist us.
Rob Critchlow, there has been a contract on Bilal Hamze's head since at least February. He was aware of that, and of course New South Wales Police have a duty of care to advise him of that. Do you have any feedback from your officers as to what his attitude was to the fact that he had a price on his head?
Members of my command, Strike Force Raptor and City Central Police, have interacted with Mr. Hamze on a number of occasions across the course of the year, including when he was charged earlier this year with possession of drugs. He's been warned that he's at risk. He's been given advice as to his safety, and that advice was not received in the sense it was given. So yeah, he sought to live his life the way he wanted to, and he's made some choices. And the police were certainly concerned. We've been monitoring the situation. As I said, there are regular things that arise in the criminal space that we act upon quietly and in a way that doesn't draw attention, and we avert a lot of these crime. But ultimately, if a violent criminal group wish to use violence towards another person to achieve their aims, they will do it. And what we do then, we gather the evidence and we lock them up.
You mentioned that this one line of inquiry is whether it's linked to Ironside. Can you just elaborate on why you think that's so early investigation?
What Ironside showed us, there was a substantial proportion of the criminal community using that particular platform, the ANOM platform, to communicate an organised crime. As we've looked into the evidence, it's astounding how overt and comfortable they were in communicating through that platform, which means they were comfortable in what they were doing. The disruption caused by the intervention of the Federal Police-led operation in partnership with us and the other state agencies was to throw a spanner in the works, as it were. So we're quite sure that this has had an impact. What it also illustrates is that the risk to the community from encrypted communications and dedicated encrypted devices remains severe. This allows criminals to organise themselves to arrange violence, arrange drug dealing and money laundering with reduced risk of being arrested. So whilst Ironside was a great success and we've had massive achievements off that, there are still platforms and devices which cause us great concern, which are being used in these offences, and some of those devices you will know of. And we really hope to see some legislative support for us in the future to really act upon these devices and get them out of criminals' hands.
Did Hamze's name pop up during that investigation?
Not in an actionable sense, otherwise he would have been locked up last week. So, but there is still a lot of material working through, and it's probably important to remind our criminal occupants of Sydney and New South Wales is that we have vast amounts of data, which we haven't worked our way through yet. So whilst there's a lot of activity the last few weeks, it's going to continue. And several offenders that have been using these platforms with disregard will be locked up over the course of the next few months.
What was this person arrested for this morning?
He was arrested for money laundering and related offences.
Related to this at all? Or?
Not this particular offence, but he's a member of an organised crime group. He's a functionary. As we well know, history shows that whilst there are a number of violent offenders in any criminal group, and drug traffickers is also people that make things happen behind the scenes, and this is a person that was an enabler of this crime group.
And are Raptor or crim groups out doing like FBO searches and things this morning?
Yes, we're out right now. We're out right now, and we'll be going across the next few days intensely, and then over the next few weeks as demand and intelligence drives us.
How real is the risk of reprisals?
Substantial. There is a substantial risk of reprisals, and we certainly appeal to those that choose that are concerned about this and then choose to use violence to take reprisals or revenge against others. We want them to stop. This cycle of violence is damaging everybody in this town and this state. It causes great fear in the public, and it's really not the way to achieve anything. We would rather anyone who has the idea of using violence and revenge to come to us and use the police to arrest these offenders. It's a much better way than using violence in public streets. We've received some information this morning about some possible risks, and we'll certainly be acting upon those.
If crooks aren't going to listen to police telling them what to do, which is a natural reaction from them, should they at least listen perhaps to their own family members? Bilal Hamze's own mother was her house was shot up, and she was individually shot. There must be pressure from inside those family groups to rein these young men in. Are you aware of any pressure? Is there infighting in the family to stop this sort of activity?
Look, every family's got different members, and we all know in our own families we've got members we like and members we don't. But the fact is that people suffer from these offences, and while we're pointing towards Mr. Hamze as having a criminal history and being associated with a criminal fraternity, he's a human. He has parents, he has grandparents, he has cousins, people that care about him, and they're severely affected by this. They're all under pressure. We've seen households and houses being shot at over the last few months and years that belong to members of the extended family, have nothing to do with a crime, that are good people, but they're having bullets into their homes all hours of the day and night. And this cycle has got to stop. It achieves nothing except pain for the community, and we'll do all we can with our partners to make sure it happens. Thank you.